Following fertilization, which takes place inside the fallopian tube of the female reproductive system, that zygote that is formed begins to move along the fallopian tube and towards the cavity of the uterus. Now, as it moves along the blastocyst, it begins to divide in a process known as cleavage, and eventually it forms a structure known as a morula. Now, a morula consists of these individual tiny identical cells known as blastomeres, and eventually that morula will make its way to the cavity of the uterus. Now, inside the uterus, we have the lining of the uterus known as the endometrium. And the endometrium contains these special glands that secrete a nutritious fluid. And that fluid, which is found inside the cavity of the uterus, is used to basically initiate the process known as blastulation. So once the morula is inside that cavity of the uterus, it undergoes blastulation to form a blastocyst. Now, recall that a blastocyst consists of three important structures. We have the blastocele, which is the hollow cavity inside the blastocyst that contains a nutritious fluid that is needed by that developing embryo to actually develop further. We also have a structure known as the trophoblast and the inner cell mass. Now, the cells, part of the trophoblast, eventually give rise to a structure known as the chorion as well as the placenta, while the cells of the inner cell mass eventually give rise to the actual organism itself. Now, following the formation of the blastocyst finds itself inside the fluid found inside the cavity of the uterus. What exactly happens next? Well, for the blastocyst to develop further, it must actually implant itself onto the endometrium, the lining of the uterus. And in this lecture, we're going to focus on this process of implantation, and we're going to discuss how it takes place and what happens after implantation actually takes place. So let's begin by taking a look at the following diagram, diagram A. In diagram A, we basically describe the lining of the uterus we call the endometrium. So we have connective tissue and we have vascular tissue. We have these cells shown in light pink as well as the red cells that make up the epithelium of that endometrium. And we also have these blood vessels that carry the oxygen and the nutrients and so forth along this endometrium. Now, this is the actual blastocyst. So we have the dark purple cells is the trophoblast, and these light purple cells are the inner cell mass, and this inside and this inner cavity is the blastocele. It contains that fluid. Now, notice that our blastocyst implants itself along the section of the trophoblast that is adjacent to the inner cell mass, and that's because the inner cell mass needs to be as close to the vascular tissue of the endometrium, because it's the inner cell mass that eventually gives rise to that individual, to that organism. Now, as soon as attachment actually takes place, the cells of the trophoblast, these dark purple cells, begin to release digestive enzymes. And what these digestive enzymes do is they dig a hole inside the endometrium that can accommodate that implanting embryo. So the embryo slowly begins to make its way into the endometrium of that uterus. Now, implantation takes place on about the seventh day following fertilization. Now, what happens next? Well, by about the 10th day, that entire implanting embryo is found entirely inside the endometrium as shown in the following diagram. And notice that these cells continue to secrete these digestive enzymes that even further break down this area surrounding that implanting embryo. Notice what also happens. Because these digestive enzymes come in close proximity with these blood vessels, the blood vessels are also actually broken down. And what happens is this creates a temporary source of nutrition, of oxygen and nutrients such as glucose and so forth. And this eventually will develop into something called the placenta. So we have these blood vessels that now are in slight contact with this region of our embryo. So by the way, this is what eventually forms the chorion. So in a way, this is our chorion. Notice what we also form is something called the umbilical vesicle, and the umbilical vesicle will eventually become part of the umbilical cord. Now we have these inner cell mass that eventually opens up and creates this cavity inside known as the amniotic cavity, and this will eventually be the place where that embryo is actually found, where that individual is actually found, as we'll see in just a moment. Now, notice another thing that actually happens is we form this surrounding layer of epithelial cells around that embryo that implanted. So basically, in this case, we have the breaking of these cells so that the embryo can actually make its way. But once it makes its way into the endometrium, we have blood clots that are formed within this area, and eventually these new epithelial cells reform this epithelium, and now the entire embryo is found entirely inside the endometrium. Now, what happens next? Well, after about 25 days following fertilization, we have something like this. Basically, what happens is now we no longer have a temporary connection between the mother's blood vessels and the chorion portion of the embryo. Now we have a direct connection between the chorion and the uterine blood vessels. And so what that means is we have this continual source of nutrition and oxygen that comes from the mother. We also form the embryonic stalk that eventually becomes that umbilical cord. And this connection between the chorion and the blood vessels of the mother eventually forms the placenta. Now notice this is our umbilical vesicle that eventually becomes part of the umbilical cord. We also have this amniotic cavity that eventually grows in size in order to accommodate that embryo, that organism that develops inside, as shown in the following diagram. So this is the amnion, this is the amniotic cavity. Inside the amniotic cavity, we have the fluid that basically acts as a nutritious source for that embryo. It also absorbs some of that shock that the embryo can actually experience. And this entire section is the chorionic cavity. It is also filled with a fluid that not only provides nutrition to the cells surrounding, but it also acts as an absorbent. It absorbs the forces and the shocks that the embryo can actually experience. So this is the process of implantation, and these describe what happens following implantation. In the next lecture, we're going to discuss something called gastrulation.